One of the questions that has puzzled people since the beginning of time is, well, the beginning of time. We're pretty sure the universe started with what's known as the Big Bang, but much of our evidence for what happened in the early universe actually comes from information hundreds of thousands of years later. How do we measure the Big Bang? And how could our favourite friends, neutrinos, revolutionise our understanding of the early universe? That's what we're talking about today on Even Bananas. When you think about the Big Bang, your first thought might not be neutrinos, but it is if you're a neutrino physicist. The Big Bang should have created equal amounts of matter and antimatter, which annihilate if they come into contact. So how did we end up with a matter-filled universe? It's possible that neutrinos could be part of that answer. For more on that topic, check out this video. Today, we're exploring neutrinos in the early universe and how we can use them to learn more about the time just after the Big Bang. Initially, the conditions after the Big Bang were so intense, nuclei and atoms couldn't form. It was a plasma of high-energy particles so hot and dense that nothing could travel very far without interacting. Not even neutrinos. As the universe aged, different particles decoupled from the plasma, meaning they stopped interacting and started behaving more like the particles we know. We often talk about the cosmic microwave background, or CMB, as photons from the Big Bang. But actually, these photons decoupled from the plasma about 370,000 years afterwards. Still, the CMB is the oldest direct observation we have of the early universe, and detecting these photons has allowed us to see billions of years back in time. So, what about neutrinos? Well, we know neutrinos interact less than photons, so as you may have guessed, neutrinos decoupled much, much earlier than photons. We estimate roughly 1 second after the Big Bang. In our supernova episode, we discussed how neutrinos leave the core of a supernova before the light does, because neutrinos only interact through the weak force, whereas photons interact through the electromagnetic force, which is stronger. Similarly, in the early universe, neutrinos decoupled from the plasma early on, while photons were stuck interacting electromagnetically with this soup of other particles for a few hundred thousand more years. These Big Bang relic neutrinos should still be around today, and scientists officially call them the cosmic neutrino background, or CNB. If we could measure them, we could see a neutrino picture from when the universe was just 1 second old. That would be a very different picture from the one we see with photons, and it would give us a lot of useful information. Or at least, that's the dream. Here's the problem. We haven't yet measured the cosmic neutrino background because these neutrinos are extremely low energy. We estimate they started out with about 500 to 1,000 times lower energy than the neutrinos we make in our accelerators at Fermilab. Those would be hard to spot in our detectors, but maybe not impossible. However, in the 13.8 billion years since the Big Bang, they've lost a ton more energy through something called cosmological redshift. To understand cosmological redshift, we need two key ingredients: the expansion of the universe and wave-particle duality. First, we know that the universe is expanding, which means that space-time itself is stretching out. Second, wave-particle duality tells us that we can think of a neutrino as a wave just as much as a particle. Our previous video introduced wave packets, which look something like this. As space-time expands, the wave packet stretches out, like a piece of string pulled tighter. The wavelength gets longer. If it was a light wave, it would move towards the red end of the visible spectrum, thus redshift. We use the same words to describe what happens to a neutrino wave, even though there's no light or colours involved. So we can calculate the energy of the wave using this formula. If the wavelength gets bigger, then the energy of the wave gets smaller. The amount that a particle wave stretches depends on how long it's been travelling through the universe. Our CNB neutrinos have been travelling since the Big Bang, so they've stretched a lot and lost most of their energy. They started with about 1 to 2 MeV of energy, but they're now estimated to be hundreds of billions of times lower. That's many orders of magnitude smaller than the lowest energy neutrinos we've ever detected. We previously explored how neutrinos generally travel at almost the speed of light. CMB neutrinos are the exception. They have such low energies that they are non-relativistic. These neutrinos have speeds 3,000 times slower than the speed of light. Although they still travel about 85 kilometers a second, so you still couldn't beat one in a race. Measuring these super slow, low energy neutrinos is obviously a challenge, but we would learn so much if we could do it. There are some cool ideas out there, including an experiment called Ptolemy, which aims to measure the cosmic neutrino background using tritium. Very low energy neutrinos could capture on a tritium atom and cause it to eject an electron in an inverse beta decay process. Measuring these electrons from the CMB neutrinos will require an extremely sensitive detector, and no one has built a detector capable of it yet, but there's a lot of exciting technology being developed for Ptolemy. Someone once said to me that every neutrino physicist goes through a phase where they want to measure the cosmic neutrino background, and it's pretty true. It would be a truly groundbreaking measurement. We wouldn't just learn about neutrinos, we'd have a window right back to the start of the universe. And we've got big dreams here on Even Bananas. What do you think is the most interesting thing about these early universe neutrinos? Let us know in the comments. And don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to hear more about probably the oldest, but definitely the best particles in the universe. Fun fact, physicist Fred Hoyle coined the term the Big Bang in radio broadcasts during the 1950s. Ironically, Hoyle was arguing against the theory, known at the time as Friedman cosmology. Instead, he promoted his competing steady-state theory to describe the universe. Hoyle changed his tune in 1963 with the discovery of the cosmic microwave background, the most conclusive evidence to date in support of the Big Bang theory.